what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk a little bit about how air and fire interact. Okay? That way you'll get your air.
We're air.
What's your English birthday?
October 1st.
Yeah.
It's Kaf Vav Tishrei.
Okay, so, yeah. I don't say like your air. You're a person. You're a Jew. But your personality might have a lot of air in it simply because the day that you were born, and the month that you were born, the month of Tishrei in English, what did you say, October?
First.
So that's also the month. It's a month that's dominated by the quality of the four elements. It's dominated by air. So therefore, you might have that in your personality. And it's again for you to determine, not for me to tell you. But it's just a tool for you. And you're a person who's learned about fire, and your English birthday is in the month of Nisan, which is the first month of fire. It's the first month of the Jewish calendar year. And your birthdays are both in Tishrei, which is the seventh month of the year according to the Torah, but it's the first month in the calendar year. So you're all interconnected in that way. So let's see how there's an interaction. Now, the Gemara does say that this is just one part of your personality, and there's so much more to you than just the day that you were born or the month that you were born. But we'll just play with this a little bit because it's a handy tool, and it helps us with self-recognition and self-improvement, because the whole point of one of the points of life is that we didn't come here to be same old, right? Let's say by your nature, you're very angry, or you're very manipulative, or you're very shy, or you're very, needy. Whatever it is, let's say that's your nature. Since you're a little kid, you could ask your parents what you like when you were a baby. They'll tell you that there's oftentimes you can see a correlation between how little children are and how they grow up. So it's not just about, okay, I've always been shy, I'm going to be shy, I was shy, I am shy, I'm going to be shy. That's not how we live life. We live life as I was shy, I might be shy now, but can I improve that? Can I upgrade that? Can I use that in a healthy way? That's the whole point of self-knowledge. It's not just about it's cool to know about yourself, but how can I fix myself? How can I improve the world? How can I improve my family? Etc., etc. So there. And before I begin to tell you about this concept, I do want to qualify this meaning. There is an opinion in the world of Torah that you really don't need to know any of this stuff. You just need to do Torah and mitzvot. Keep the Torah, do the mitzvot, daven, learn, do all the things that are important for you. And in that way, when you live your life in that way, your soul will naturally correct. Your personality will naturally adjust and balance. There is an opinion in the Torah world that's true, and you can therefore, for those people who come to my class don't like that opinion, meaning they want to know about themselves. But there's an opinion that says whatever you can figure out about yourself is anyway relative to your own mind. So just have a good life, be a good person, do what you're supposed to do. God will then give you circumstances that will adjust you, help you, fix you, balance you. Yeah? He'll give you a child who's the exact opposite of your personality. And are any of you children opposite of your parents, and you test them and you challenge them in terms of, and that's development for them. So you're going to get the same thing. Just giving you a heads up. You're going to get one or two kids that are going to be the exact opposite of your personality, and they're going to challenge you, and they're going to help you to grow, and they're going to actually, what you're going to see about them that you don't like is exactly what you need to fix in yourself. So God will do that to you. He'll give you circumstances. Nevertheless, I think it's interesting to see if we can also a little bit learn about ourselves so we can preempt the tikkun, the fixing. Okay, so let's talk about air and how it interacts with fire. So the concept of air and earth are opposites. So of the four elements that are taught in the Torah, earth, air, fire, and water, the four elements that are taught to us in the personality, there are two pairs, the pair of fire and water, which are opposite, and the pair of air and earth, which are opposite. Why are air and earth opposite? Simply because of the way that they move. Earth doesn't move, and air always moves. So in terms of the physicality of them, earth is the most practical, physical. It's the most compacted and contracted of the four elements. And air has no physicality, almost. It has the least amount of physicality. And it moves, and it's always changing and shifting. Earth is always grounded and stable. Earth is the physical world. Air is the more spiritual world. That's the earth-air opposite. So that's in earth-air. But now we're going to talk about air vis-a-vis fire. Okay, so the air element in you is a part of you that can change, that can actually, you know, adapt, and that has the least amount of connection to the physical world. What is the part of you that has the least amount of connection to the physical world in your body? I'll do it quickly. It's your mind. Your body needs to eat, to sleep, but your mind is, and it needs to rest. Your mind is always, always moving. Your body can do maybe a couple of things at the same time, but your mind can do thousands of things at the same time. Right now, as we're sitting here learning, your mind is, bless you, is regulating every one of the organs in your body. Your mind is not is a non-stop computer. And so the mind is always changing and moving. But we don't feel that. We don't feel that movement, but it's happening within us. The Torah tells us that in another element, another part of the air element, is the concept of communication and speech. The ability to talk. Why? Because the ability to talk and the ability to breathe are very interconnected. On a certain physical level, we breathe through our mouth and nose, and we speak through our mouth and nose. Without, you know how you sound when your nose is clogged?
Yes.
And you can't, you're experiencing an Israeli winter. Baruch Hashem, we had rain today, we're having rain today. In Hebrew, we call that Gishmei Bracha. You know what that means in Hebrew? Blessed rains. We don't just say it's raining. We say it's raining in a blessed way. So you got your nose stuff up, and you sound different, right?
Yes.
I think I'm also listening to my nose sounding a little bit. So the mouth, nose, that whole area is connected to communication. Why? So the Torah tells us because God, when he created Adam, he first created him as a body, a gush, a body, and it was not moving. It wasn't animated. It wasn't alive. And then Hashem blew. He blew into Adam, so to speak, a soul. So the Torah tells us he blew. You blow from air within you. So there was an aspect of air to that blowing. And the Torah tells us that the soul that God blew into Adam was very different than the soul he blew into animals, in that Adam was given then the ability to speak. So the blowing in of the soul into our body is the ability to speak, to communicate, and to think. All of that's one topic. That's the air element in you. And we learned about the fire element. The fire element is the fire is always, in terms of the way that they move, these four elements. So earth doesn't move, represents stability. Air always moves, represents change, and represents communication of your mind, because the mind is always moving. Fire moves upward against gravity, and water generally moves downward. If you let water, like if I would pour water onto this table, it would creep to the edge and then it would fall down with the laws of gravity. So in terms of movement, fire represents upward movement. What does that mean? That's an expression in the secular world, right? Upward movement means you get a job, you stay there for a couple of years, get your experience, then you move on. But you don't just move on, you move up. You're not going to move on to another job that's on the same level that the job is that you're at now. So that's the fire element in you, which is moving upward, which is changing for the better, which is, on a certain level, negating what you have so that you can feel the lack of what you want and then go for it. That's fire. Think about fire. Fire burns, right? So what does fire do? It burns something. It's a destructive element, yeah? But does fire burn for the sake of burning, or does it burn for the sake of giving off air, light and heat? Fire burns not for the purpose of burning, but for the purpose of something higher, which is, here I have a candle. Let's say I have a candle here. The candle is just nice and pretty. It's not accomplishing anything. Once I light it, then the light of the candle will give off light, will give off heat. So it is maximizing the potential of the candle. Yeah? That's called fire. Fire means I'm changing for the purpose of improvement. That's the nature of fire. Now, even though you guys were born in earth in air months, I'm sure you have a little bit of fire in you. Because if you didn't, you wouldn't want to come to a Torah class and change your life. What's motivating you to come here is the fire part in each one of us. Okay. Fire and air. So now we learned fire in detail, and now we're learning a little bit of air. And we know that air doesn't like borders. Air doesn't like restrictions. How do I know that? Because you can't border air. I can't put air into a container. I can put water into a container. Your water bottle is a container containing the water. I can put fire into a container. How do I do that? How do I? What? Okay, yeah, you can, a fireplace. How else can I put fire into a container, or contain fire?
Just like a wick.
Exactly, beautiful. What, remind me your name?
Melissa.
Oh, the wick itself and the candle itself, you learned it good, is a container, right? In other words, if I would light a candle, the fire would stay contained to the wick of that candle, to the physicality, to the earth element of that candle. Also, how they put out fires, right? They'll put earth around an area. Let's say you're making a, what's that called, a campfire? A bonfire, yeah? So what do you do when you're in Girl Scouts or when you're in whatever? You learn to put rocks around it or dirt, a mound of dirt, so that it doesn't spread. So yes, you can contain fire. And earth itself is a container. The earth itself, how do you contain earth? Earth by nature is contained. It doesn't move. But air, you cannot contain air. Correct? Years and years ago, they used to sell bottle of Israel air. Yeah, they would have like this cute little decorative bottle that they would wax, they would seal it waxed, and inside was the air of Israel. And people bought it. Like, okay, now what? What are you going to do with that? If you open it, so that's it. If you keep it closed, so then what is it? It's ridiculous. You can't contain air. Just like you can't contain your brain. Your brain can do millions, I don't know the exact number, I should really look it up one day, millions of activities per second is right now our brain is involved in. Things that we don't... The food that you digested yesterday, the brain has to be measuring the enzymes in your digestive system to figure out how to digest that food. And so the air, which is the power of thought, power of speech, power of movement, power of shifting and changing, doesn't like containers, doesn't like rules. People in this generation don't like rules. They like to make up their own rules. You know why? I don't put stock in these kinds of things. I'm just going to tell you that, and I'm not an astrologer or an astronomer, but everyone knows that this 50 to 100 years, you know what they call it in astrology or astronomy? The age of Aquarius. Did you ever hear that? That was a song when I was a kid. Forgive me for introducing that. The age of Aquarius. What is Aquarius? Aquarius is an air sign. It's the consciousness of, don't tell me what to do, I want to figure it out myself. Or, don't tell me what to do, I want to do what I want to do. You can't tell me what to do. That's what's going on in the planet. And that's what's going on with the Jewish world is also affected by whatever goes on in the planet. And so the air element, that's the air element that we're all in now. Okay, so air doesn't like being told what to do. They like to think about it. If you speak to an air person and you tell them a Jewish law, because remember, air and earth are opposites. Earth is a Jewish law, and air is like, I want to figure it out myself. So if you're trying to explain Judaism to a person who's primarily air, you have to explain to them, you have to either inspire them or explain to them reasons why their mind can understand. How do air and fire interact? If a person's very, very strong fire, let's say the president of elective America, he's a very strong fire personality. I don't know anything about his birthday or anything, but you see, first of all, when he speaks, he gets all red. That's a fire element. And I don't know what his natural color hair is, but I think that it looks orange to me on the paper, on the picture, so that's clearly not his natural color hair, but you don't pick a color out of nowhere. Maybe he was like that when he was a kid, I don't know. But his personality and his drive, his absolute amazing, crazy drive to accomplish the impossible, which is really what happened. His election is a pure miracle, it's a revealed miracle. That's a fire personality. Somebody who, you know, is, and I'm not saying bad about him now, just in general, a person who's in control, who wants to be in control, and who is powerful and wants power and knows what to do with power. Some people don't know what to do with power. They're given power. Let's say someone will say to you, take over this you know, take over a certain committee and I'll make you the head of a committee, or you can become the CEO of the company now. There are some people who revel in that. They know what to do with it. They feel like, good, now I can make all the changes. That's a fire personality. But a person who says, like, I don't know what to do, it's too much, it's overwhelming, that's not a fire personality. So anyone who strives the way he strives to be the president-elect of America, that's a fire personality. But now, the nature of fire is it wants to lead, it wants to rule. It's a little bit arrogant. It has a nature of arrogance. And air also has a certain, not arrogance, but self-centeredness. The negative of air could be self-centeredness. How does that come about? Because air, remember, is communication and thought. And a negative of that could be constantly rethinking the same thought. And the rethinking of that same thought is usually generally self-centered or self-focused. So air and fire understand each other and they like each other. In terms of the physicality, you know that fire needs air and air needs fire. You know that, right? Why does fire need air? Because it needs oxygen to continue to do the amazing process of combustion that Hashem created. Fire needs air. And why does air need fire? Anyone can think of why does air need fire in the physical world? Who remembers a little bit of, it's chemistry or world science. What does fire do to air?
It heats it.
Yeah, and? What happens when air is heated?
It rises.
Okay, it rises. Good. Excellent. And it moves. Yeah. Very good. So heat and air, when air is heated, it lifts it up. It rises. And then it makes the molecules move quicker. Air, the nature of air is to move. The nature of your ability, look, I'm speaking and speaking. That's the nature of air is to speak and speak. The nature of air is to think and think. The nature of air is to be all over the place and to move and to have ideas. That's the healthy nature of air. And air, but air doesn't like when it's stagnant. So you know what means stagnant? When it's not moving, when air doesn't move. Did you ever, were you ever in a summer, here in Israel, we have that sometimes where the air in Israel, especially in Yerushalayim HaKodesh, is incredibly delicious. The air here, it's like better than ice cream. When you breathe, go outside today. Today the air is very ionized because of the rain. And it's not a crazy rain, it's a beautiful rain. So the air is actually a mind sharpener. They're able to measure the ions in the air and see that the rain increases the energy, the electricity in the air. So, but when air doesn't move, you feel like you can't breathe. In the summertime, if there's no breeze, if there's no movement, if there's no, then you just like, you can't breathe, right? So air doesn't like to not move. The nature of the air is to move. It doesn't like when it doesn't move. Fire makes air move quicker, and it makes air go higher. Air loves inspiration. The nature of air, the nature of the air personality is it loves to move, it loves to think, and it loves to rise higher. That's the concept of inspiration. So air loves fire, fire loves air. The problem with both fire and air is that they don't have earth. Fire has a little bit of earth, but air has none. What is that in conceptually? What is that in the personality?
You mean something in the ground.
Exactly. They don't get anything done. Fire doesn't get anything done. It just wants to rise and rise and rise. Air doesn't get anything done. It wants to think and think and talk. So fire and air both need earth. That means that in your life, you have to actualize all the thoughts that you have. Make them happen. Do something physical. Don't just remain in the theoretical. Now, all of us are a combination of all four elements, so we can do that. In the sociological world, let's say that going back to the president-elect of America or any president, the president of generally any country or any company, a big company, is generally a fire personality. Sometimes the fire is quiet. In other words, there are you know, like on simmer. You know what that means on the stove when you put the fire on low and it's just it's constant and consistent and it's cooking, but it's not like killing anybody. So the fire element, anyone who is the principal of a school, the head of an organization, that's a fire element in them. They always need to have an earth person getting stuff done. They need a secretary. They need a personal assistant. They need, their spouse to ground them. Yeah? That's fire. Fire needs that. Air needs that. Air needs someone to say, okay, stop thinking. There's a girl here who's a genius. One of our girls here, she's a genius. Every day she comes and she says to me she has a new idea for an app. You know what means apps? Okay, so apps is this thing. I don't exactly know what it is, but it makes the world easier. Like Waze is an app. That was a very good one. I used that in America. And you know what means apps, right? Okay, so every day she has like this great idea. She has this, and she tells me these amazing, I would never in a million years think about these ideas that she thinks about. But the next day it's a new idea from a different area of life altogether. She just can't get anything done, but she has amazing ideas. So such a person needs a patent lawyer, or I don't know what she needs, to see, is it practical, is it doable, and can you make $1 million? And then, you know, go and do it. That's called air needs earth, and fire needs earth. Therefore, fire and air understand each other very much, and they like to talk to each other. The fire person needs an air person to give him or her ideas. The fire in you, you might be very inspired, you might be very, but you enjoy new ideas. Fire and air in the mind are very connected to each other. That's why in the physical body, the fire part of you is in the brain, the nervous system. Remember when you learned in biology, the nervous system? The nervous system has different types of cells. And the way that the cells move in the regular biology, the regular body, the cells move through water. And they exchange nutrients and give off the waste through the water of the cells. But the brain is an operation of fire. The way that the cells move is through electrical impulses, and the cells connect through fire. They jump over, right? The cells don't touch each other in the brain. They jump one to the other through across that synapse through an electrical impulse. That means fire is in the brain, and air is in the brain. That's why fire and air people very much interconnect and like to talk to each other, but they need the earth to pull them down. Or to get them practical. Did it ever happen to you that you were davening? Do you know it yet? You know what davening means, right? Okay, so if you're a veteran davener, like I'm Baruch Hashem, a veteran davener. I've been praying and talking to God and using the Siddur and Tehillim and my own personal prayer for Baruch Hashem decades and decades. So, but I find that as soon as I open the Siddur, and maybe you could perhaps. Now, because you're still struggling with the words, maybe you're even davening in English, so it might not happen to you, but this happens to me, that I'll open the Siddur, and all of a sudden my mind isn't like, my mind wanders. Now, I'm primarily air in my own personality, and I find that it's such a struggle for me to keep focused on the Siddur and the incredible secrets that the Siddur has to offer. Because as soon as oftentimes I'll find myself wandering into the grocery store, like, and I have a shopping list. And I'm in the middle of davening shacharis. I'm sitting in my kitchen davening, and all of a sudden, like, I'm in the grocery, or I'm on the airplane, or I'm in the travel agent, or I'm in here in school thinking about somebody who I have to meet. That's called the air, the mind. And I'm trying to be doing something practical, and it's hard because the air and the mind wanders. The same thing happens with fire. Fire is always moving. But it's always moving upwards. So it could be davening, which is a very passionate, davening is a fire, air mitzvah. Of course it needs the body, every mitzvah needs the body, but primarily davening is a thought process, it's a communication process, it's a talking to God process. So fire and air are always moving, and sometimes during the davening, the fire also wants to achieve higher levels of davening, of inspiration. So sometimes when I'm davening, I'll have great ideas. This happens to me a lot. In the middle of davening, I'll have this great idea of a class that I'm going to give, or a recipe I'm going to do, or have to tell this person something, or that person's, the solution to that person's life problem just came into my head. It happens during davening. And you would think, oh, that's good. At least you have all these great ideas. But no, that's not good. That's a Yetzer Hara interrupting my davening to bombard me with the same type of energy. Davening is air, thoughts and fire. Thoughts are air and fire. So my challenge is focus just on the davening and don't let those other thoughts of fire and air interrupt you. I always find, and how do I know that this is a challenge as opposed to a gift from God? You might say, well, wait a minute, you're davening now and, you know, your mind is open to God and to goodness, and so that's when God is introducing into your mind all these amazing thoughts. You might say that, but how do I know it's not true and that's a challenge? Because as soon as I finish davening, number one, I forget the thoughts. Number two, I realize, oh, that was such a stupid idea. That was such a stupid conversation I just had in my head. I realize that those thoughts are not real, are not practical, and are not, I don't follow through on them. So it's all one big challenge. Okay. Fire and air interact in communication, in conversation, and in achievement. The air wants the fire to succeed. Therefore, a fire person, let's say the head of an organization, or the head of a school, or the head of a family, that's the fire element. That person takes counsel with the air element person or with the air element in themselves. And they're comfortable doing that. There's no contradiction. So fire and air get along well in the world of thoughts and communication. They do not interact in the world of action. They're in different places in the world of action. So if you have a person who's primarily earth, let's just say, a person who's very practical, down to earth, logical, bordered, strong borders, strong clarity of morals, that person is wonderful as a friend for fire and air, but not naturally, they don't gravitate towards each other naturally. The part of you that's conflicted, if a person has a conflict between what they want to achieve and how they're going to do that, right? You want to become president. You want to own a company. The earth part of you says, do it in a moral, kosher, structured, logical way. Inside your own mind, you're thinking that. The earth part of you in your mind says, you know, you want to achieve something, do it legally. The air part and the fire part rebel against that. And they say, no, I just want to get it done. Let's get this done. And however I do it, you know, the means justify the ends. The ends justify the means. You know that expression? What I'm going to do in the end is going to justify how I get to it. The ends justify the means. That's a conflict that a person might have within themselves between the fire air and the earth. The earth is always telling you, be good. Be down to earth. Stay true to your morals. Don't get off track. That's the earth part of you. The earth part of you says, I have a belief system, and I'm going to hold on to that belief system no matter what. The air and the fire in you says, I can change that every once in a while. I can, you know, modify. It's not so bad. Rationalization. That's all air and fire. So the earth part of you is what says, no, wait a minute. Mommy taught you this. Daddy taught you this. The Torah teaches you this. God expects this from you. That's all earth. Yeah? So the earth part of you, whenever you see that your mind is going to a never land, or you have expectations or hopes, the earth part of you has to ground you. Yeah? Let's talk about expectations. Rav Dessler, in his book, Michtav Meliyahu, in English they translated it as Strive for Truth. Anyone ever saw that? It's in the library here. And it's a very wonderful book to read. So that was one of my first svarim that I learned independently when I was in high school. I love that book. And all those years back, there weren't a lot of different books available, svarim available, that first of all were available and second of all were understandable. Anyway, so I remember learning that book. So I don't remember it, and I did it in Hebrew, so I don't know in English what volume it's in. But in the Hebrew volume, it's in the second, in the Hebrew sect set of this Michtav Me'Eliyahu, Strive for Truth, it was the second volume. And there he talks about the concept of loving people and having being in a relationship with people. And he says something there that I remember I underlined it. I still have that sefer. I underlined it and I exclamation pointed it. And I wrote a big question mark because I didn't get it. I knew it was important, but I didn't get it. Now I understand it, years and years later. And he says the following. He says, and when you love somebody, think about any kind of loving relationship that you have. When you love somebody, so the percentage in your emotions of the amount of how much you want to give to that person, put that into a number. And the percentage of how much you expect from that person, put that into a number. So let's just say, I'll make it easy for you. Let's just say you have a 70%, you want to give and give and give to that person. But you have 30% expectations that the person should give you back. So he said, you're going to be 30% miserable in that relationship. The same percentage of expectation that you have from another person in life, anybody, it could be a person that you feel, okay, it's logical to expect that that person would give back, right? That percentage of expectation is your percentage of misery in that relationship. And the highest level, now again, I didn't understand that when I was a teenager. Because, like, why else would you have a parent if not that they should, I love you, and you love me. You're my mommy, you're my daddy, you have to give me, right? Like, everybody, if you're honest, you have expectations of your parents. You certainly have expectations of friends. The biggest counseling that we do in friends when people are upset, you'll hear, I do everything for my roommate. I do everything for her, and you know what? I get back nothing. That's the most often repeated pain that a person might have in the roommate situation here, and certainly in spouses. So, and then even with your own children, you have expectations. Children, you know? No, Rav Zesso says, in relationships, Hashem gives us relationships in this world. This is going to sound weird, and perhaps because you're still in your teenage years or you're young, a little bit, yeah, I know, you're not teenagers, but you're like a little bit past that. So it might be hard for you to hear this, but Rav Zesler says that other people are in your life only to make you God-like. What is God? The ultimate of God is giving. God is the giver. There's nothing we can give him. He is the creator of everything, of this whole entire system. He is above. We can't even use words like creator and system because he created the concepts of a creator. Whatever it is, Hashem is constantly HaMechadesh B'tzuvo B'chol Yom Tamid. We say this in Davening. Ma'aseh B'reishit. Hashem is every nanosecond. He is recreating this universe. Right, okay, so we're taught that one of his kindnesses to us is that we can be in relationship with him, we can talk to him, we can pray to him, we can praise him, and he accepts that. But really, he's above and beyond our understanding. And so, Rav Dessler says, we're given people in our life to imitate that we should be God-like in that God is the ultimate in giving, and only if you have people in your life can you also imitate God as being a giver. God has no demands or expectations or needs from us at all. The fact that he wants us to do mitzvot, that's because he wants it for our souls. And he wants us to fix and to keep his creation working. That's what Torah mitzvot do. It's for us, not for him. He doesn't need my prayer. He doesn't need my blessing. And in his kindness, he tells us that he likes our prayers and he likes our blessings, but he doesn't need it. So in relationships, the people in your life are given to you so that you have the ability to give. It's a hard concept because we're all in relationships to receive. We all want to have like a relationship is back and forth, right? That's what you're taught. So Rav Dessler says, yeah, it is. And we're all humans, and we're going to all fall into this pattern of I need and I want and I expect. But you should know that that's going to be the source of your disappointment in relationships. And if you can get to the place of just giving, that place is a much holier and healthier and happier place to be. Okay, so that's the concept of in the relationship of air and fire. These two get along well, and they need earth. Let's talk about the water, just to stick that in for a second. How does water work with fire and air? Okay, water is pleasure. We learned about water, and for those of you who didn't, so I'm just going to tell you quickly. Water is about pleasure and about enjoying life, about appreciating the blessings that we have, about being a sociable person, a social person, that's water. Friendships and enjoying people and enjoying everything in this world, that's called water. Music, art, culture, creativity, food, beauty, music, all of that, that's all water. Being a people person, that's water. So what is water? And a person, you might find people in this world who are primarily water. Everything has to be pleasant, everything has to be fun, everything has to be enjoyable. They'll never, ever want to get involved in an argument or make anyone feel bad or, you know, make an muddy water. They don't like that. So how does a water, if you think about a person in your personality who might be a primarily water, they're always fun to be around. They're the most popular, the most beautiful, they're the most into beauty. They are careful with what they wear. They put together an outfit, and that's the water part of you. But a person who might be primarily water, how do they help a person who's primarily air or primarily fire? Anybody have a thought?
Helps them appreciate the physical.
Yeah, exactly. A person who's air and fire are always in the mode of either movement up or thinking about expansion. They don't always enjoy life. They don't always enjoy life. Why? Because they're so busy moving. They're so busy accomplishing. They're so busy thinking. They're so busy communicating. So that the water person says, wait a minute, let's go out to eat. What do you mean go out to eat? What are we going to accomplish? What are we going to do? Who are we going to meet? Who are we going to see? How are we going to... No, let's just go out and eat and sit and enjoy. You have any people that like that in your life? Or are you like that in someone's life? That's the water element trying to help a person who's strongly fire or strongly air just enjoy life. Is it a mitzvah to enjoy life? What do you think? Why? Yeah, you're all nodding your heads. Why? Why do you think it's a mitzvah to enjoy life? She's an air person. She's not so sure. Yeah? She did not.
Because God is, like, infinitely good.
Okay.
To receive.
Oh, so he wants you to. So, right? Very, very good. So God is giving and giving and giving. The biggest gift that you can give to a giver is to receive what he gives. If I give you a bouquet of flowers, and you think flowers is a stupid waste of money and a stupid waste of time, right? But if you receive it graciously and say, oh, how beautiful, and thank you, you've just given me a gift of receiving what I've just given you. Whereas if you say, like, oh, thanks, and give it to your kid and say, like, go give this to the neighbor, right? So you haven't received my gift. You haven't given me back the satisfaction. So God is a giver, and he wants us to receive his gifts, yes. Should we enjoy life on our level? Yes. And how do we make sure that we don't over-enjoy life? Meaning, enjoy things that we're not supposed to enjoy? How do we make sure? Huh?
Be friends with Earth.
Okay, you can be friends with Earth. What is that in Judaism?
Torah.
Exactly, Torah and mitzvot, halacha, Jewish law. Jewish law says enjoy this world, but wait a minute. Let's just make the boundaries of what you're allowed to enjoy. Otherwise, you're going to become crazy. Because this world is magnetically attracting. It's addicting, addictive, right? So the halacha is, yeah, you can enjoy, but here's how you can enjoy, yeah? Okay, so water tells the fire person, you have to enjoy life a little bit. Don't just go for the next job. Do you like that job? Do you want to be president of the United States? Do you want to be president of the United States? Do you really want that? Is that going to bring you pleasure? Is that going to bring you, are you going to enjoy the day-to-day? You have to ask yourself that question. One of my students is one of these high achievers. I have lots of students, and they're amazing people, high achievers, always being offered the next rung in the corporation. So she was promoted now to become in her school. She's like gone from this to this, tops, now she's a director. And she's very fire air. So I said to her, do you enjoy the day today? Now, I'm not so much water myself, but at least I recognize that she's coming home every day exhausted and drained, and she doesn't have patience for her kids. And she's mamish drained. Her husband, they're both amazing people, amazing, hardworking people, and both of them keep getting promoted. So I said to her, Mamala, are you enjoying this? Like, okay, so now you got an extra, she makes a lot of money. Like in America, I think you need a lot of money. But do you enjoy that? So she had to figure out, like, does she enjoy it? Because if she doesn't enjoy it, if there's no water, then the fire will burn you out and the air will scatter you. Yeah? So the fire person and the air person needs the water person. And in our bodies, in ourselves, when you feel that you're becoming too caught up in the crazy, right? You have to do something watery. Enjoy. Do something pleasant. Do something that you enjoy. I'll tell you how I employ this, because I know myself. I don't know you guys so much, but I've been spending a lot of time with myself, like my whole life, so I know myself. So I know that I have a lot of air in me, and I'm always in my head thinking and talking and teaching and Baruch Hashem, and I'm so grateful for that. But I need exercise. I need to move. Now, air is exercise. But I don't like going on a treadmill. It's just, to me, a waste of time. It annoys me. So for me to go to a gym, I'll do it for, like, say, a week or two. But I don't have consistency in that, because air doesn't have consistency in certain things that they don't. So what will I do? When I really feel that I have to take a walk or I have to do exercise, I'll put on, you have such a thing called these headphones. There's such a, you can get on your phone. You know how to do that, right? I'll put on headphones and I'll listen to music, water, to enjoy the walk, or I listen to a shiur, but not the kind of shiur that I have to think and take notes, but, you know, a speaker that I just enjoy, lots of good stories or lots of good jokes or whatever. That's called introducing in your own life water. When you're too much air, fire, meaning everything has to have a purpose, air and fire, everything has to have a purpose, and water is just like, just do a nice thing to make your life a pleasant, because if you don't know how to do that for yourself, you're not going to have to do that, you're not going to know how to do that for other people. Make their life pleasant. So introduce water into your system, meaning the concept of, this is concept, the idea of do something that you like, pleasurable. That's why I never saw, I think I did see this once, that in a gym, they have TV screens now. Did you know that? You know all the stuff, right? It was a novelty to me that in a gym, now you can watch TV while you're running on the treadmill or walk on the treadmill. That way you're having water. You're enjoying it if you don't like exercise. Some people like exercising. I don't know. They like look so miserable when they're doing it, though. But they like it, so they don't need to watch the TV screen. But people watching a TV screen now, watching a movie while they're running. Okay, you got it? You got how all of that works? Who has a question on just today, what we learned today? How are you going to implement this today? Now I'm going to ask you a very down-to-earth question. Each of you has to now do this. I want you to implement something in your life today. I want you to have your homework. Try to figure out where your earth, air, water, fire continuum is today, and see if you can balance it. See if you notice in yourself, today I'm much too much air. Maybe that's good. Maybe you never talk, and today you have an appointment with somebody to speak to when you're really going to get out all your air. That's good. That's appropriate. But if you can notice in yourself a certain area of extremism or a certain area of a lack, if you're lacking something, and then can you use this system to do something to balance or to introduce or to upgrade or to diminish? Yeah? Can you do that? Can you think about that? Otherwise, this is silly. If we're just learning, it's cool, but it's not. If you don't make it practical, think about a certain mitzvah, for example, a certain Torah mitzvah that maybe is hard for you. Maybe the idea is hard for you. Maybe the theory is hard for you. Maybe the application is hard for you. and see why it's hard. Is it your earth, air, fire, or water that's making it hard for you? And then see how you can adjust that, how you can improve that. Yeah? Okay.